On November the 4th, 1942, the armoured divisions of the British 8th Army smashed their way through the line of the German Panzerarmee Africa. In the deserts of Egypt, one of the most decisive engagements of the Second World War was at an end. The triumph of the 8th Army at the Battle of El Alamein proved to be a turning point in the struggle to control North Africa. And for British Prime Minister Winston Churchill, it marked the end of the beginning of the Second World War. But there was still more fighting to be done on the dry lands of North Africa. In the weeks that followed El Alamein, the German Field Marshal Rommel was able to withdraw his African army as his British rival Montgomery took up the chase. In the early days of November 1942, Montgomery could be well pleased with the progress of the Desert War. As he began his westward pursuit of Rommel, the 8th Army commander knew that a massive Allied operation was about to begin on the other side of the African continent. This was the biggest amphibious landing ever undertaken. Codenamed Torch, the operation was a joint British-American enterprise under the command of General Dwight D. Eisenhower. Three huge task forces were organized to bring an entirely new Allied army to the lands of North Africa. On November the 8th, 1942, a total of 107,000 troops prepared to go ashore on the coasts of Morocco and Algeria. At the time, both countries were colonies of Vichy France. There were no Germans or Italians waiting for the Allied troops in November 1942, but there were French colonial troops loyal to the Vichy regime. The Allies could not be sure how they would react to the invasion. Eisenhower and his fellow commanders were also concerned that the full force of the Axis enemy was likely to be present before their final objective could be achieved. But it was a worthwhile and ambitious objective. The plan was to force the enemy out of North Africa for good and open the way for an attack on Sicily and Italy beyond. It was a time that saw some of the most gripping confrontations of the Second World War. This was the battlefield of Tunisia. In July 1942, the political leaders in Washington and London made the decision to open a new front in the battle against Hitler and the Axis powers. At the time, Allied resources were still not powerful enough to risk a full-scale assault on Northwest Europe. But there was a strong desire to bring American troops into action as quickly as possible. Anything that could draw enemy resources away from the terrible fighting in the Soviet Union would be a positive development for the Allied cause. There was also a strong desire to familiarize British and American forces with the idea of fighting alongside each other. By September, it was decided to launch a new offensive in the North African war that already had been raging for two long years. For the first time, the British and Americans were to join forces in a vast naval operation codenamed Torch. By the beginning of November, three Allied fleets were sailing towards strategic locations in the northwest of the African continent. It was a massive logistical enterprise. From the east coast of the United States, the Western Task Force sailed towards the Moroccan port of Casablanca. From ports in Scotland, the Central and Eastern Task Forces journeyed through the Straits of Gibraltar in the direction of two key ports in Algeria, Oran and Algiers. The Eastern Task Force was alone in containing British troops among its number. There were strong political reasons behind this decision. Morocco and Algeria were colonies administered by the rump French state based at Vichy, and the Vichy regime held a strong anti-British feeling. It had no diplomatic ties with Britain, but it did maintain contact with the United States. For this reason, Operation Torch was intended to look as much like an American enterprise as possible. But the United States was still not ready to launch an operation of the size of Torch without the assistance of the British, and the strategic prize on offer in North Africa was simply too good to ignore in late 1942. A successful landing in Morocco and Algeria could lead to the capture of Tunisia. There was now the chance to force the enemy out of North Africa for good. On the map, the Allied plan was obvious. The new Anglo-American army would sweep forward from the west, while the British-led 8th Army advanced from the east. And by the time of the Torch landings, this existing North African army was already moving forward. By early November 1942, times were changing in the Desert War. On the 4th, Montgomery sealed his great victory at El Alamein as Rommel's Panzer Armee began a retreat through Libya. The next day, the Central and Eastern Task Forces passed through the Straits of Gibraltar. At the same time, the Western Task Force approached the Atlantic coast of Morocco. Operation Torch was about to begin. Allied commanders knew that the Torch landings would not be opposed by Axis forces. But as H hour approached, they could not be sure how French colonial troops on the ground would respond. This was just one uncertainty in the minds of the Allied commanders in the early hours of the 8th of November 1942, as the biggest amphibious landing in history began. In the weeks prior to the Torch landings, the Allies made a series of secret diplomatic efforts in an attempt to make the Torch landings as smooth as possible. Their aim was to gain support for the operation amongst French commanders in North Africa and in France itself. After much debate, the French war hero General Henri Giraud was identified as the key figure to bring his countrymen over to the Allied side in North Africa. On the eve of the landings, he was secretly picked up by a British submarine off the coast of southern France. His destination was Eisenhower's headquarters inside the Rock of Gibraltar, where he awaited developments with interest. But Allied attempts to drum up support amongst the French were thwarted by an excess of secrecy about their intentions. Giraud himself was only given full details at the last minute, and when the first landing craft left the task force fleets on November the 8th, there was still uncertainty about how the French would react on the ground. In a matter of minutes, the Allies had their answer. At all three landing sites, the local forces fought back against the invasion. At Algiers, two British destroyers made a direct assault on the port to land an attack group of 650 Americans. The local French commander's response was to unleash his harbour artillery against the British ships. HMS Malcolm was hit and forced to withdraw. HMS Broke was sent to the bottom, and the American attack group was forced to surrender to the colonial French forces. Fortunately for the Allies, the supporting landings to the east and west of Algiers faced less in the way of resistance. Despite further engagements with French troops, the Eastern Task Force succeeded in landing armoured American units, which swept quickly into the Algerian capital. On the first afternoon, the local French commander in Algiers made the decision to surrender. The first objective of Operation Torch had been achieved. The Central Task Force met with a similar response from Vichy forces. At Oran, another direct assault on the port was met by French artillery fire, and two landing ships were sunk in the harbour. 300 American lives were lost. The supporting landings also met with a vigorous French response, with heavy ground fighting on the beaches to the west of Oran before the Americans were able to put all their men ashore. But on the second day, the French mounted a counter-attack against the newly landed forces. The intervention of American Honey tanks was required before Oran eventually fell on the 10th of November. But it took 600 American casualties, with 275 killed, to secure the objective. In Morocco, the American landings also met with fierce resistance. At Casablanca, the direct assault on the port was opposed by a French battleship, the Jean Bar. The vessel was unfinished and certainly not fit for sea, but her four 15-inch guns were in perfect working order, as the Americans soon found out. A full-scale battle between the Jean Bar and the USS Massachusetts broke out, an engagement that only ended with the intervention of Allied bombers. The supporting landings also had to fight their way towards the Casablanca objective, with their efforts hampered by difficulties unloading material on the landing beaches. The Western Task Force commander, George Patton, was furious. By the morning of the 11th of November, the Casablanca objective had still not been achieved, as the French continued to resist. But then the fighting came to a sudden end. In Algiers, the French announced an armistice. By chance, the deputy leader of Vichy France was in the city, and it was Admiral Jean-François Darlin who realized that further resistance was futile. Though Darlin's seniority within the Vichy regime led many to suspect him of Nazi sympathies, his accidental presence in Algiers meant that he became the French High Commissioner in Allied-occupied North Africa, much to the annoyance of Henri Giraud. But Darlin's authority in North Africa was short-lived. 6 weeks after the Allied landings, he fell victim to an assassin's bullet in the Algerian capital. His true loyalties remained in doubt until the end, and many Allied leaders were pleased when his death cleared the way for Henri Giraud to take over French administration in North Africa. But it was Darlin's armistice that brought the torch landings to a successful conclusion, and the Allied command could be pleased with the first Anglo-American operation of the war, despite their losses at the hands of the French. Allied ground troops were immediately formed into the new British-led First Army of General Kenneth Anderson, and the objective of Tunisia could now be pursued. But a far more substantial enemy had already reacted to events. On the same day as the Algiers armistice, German troops marched into Vichy France. In the days that followed, Axis troops and material poured into Tunisia to meet the Allied advance. These were the first units of a new Axis force in Africa, the 5th Panzer Army. The Allied march to Tunis would not be unopposed. The Allied leadership's desire to occupy Tunisia can be easily understood. If Tunisia fell, the Allies would be in a position to attack Sicily and take the war forward into the enemy's home territory. But the presence of Axis fighters in Sicily and southern Italy meant that Operation Torch could not land forces directly in Tunisian territory. Allied troops had to advance on the ground to claim the prize. Speed was of the essence. On November the 10th, before the French ceasefire had even been announced, some 33,000 Allied troops left Algiers in the direction of Tunisia. It was possible that their objective could be achieved by Christmas. At first, their progress was good. By the 16th of November, advance units of the British First Army had reached the Tunisian settlement of Souk El Arba. But 4 days later, the first contact with the enemy was made, and Axis air power began to tell as the Allied supply lines were stretched. The Messerschmitt Bf 109 began to appear in North African skies, flying low to harass the advancing Allied infantry. On occasions, the Bf 109 pilots flew so low that not even the famous Bofors 40mm anti-aircraft gun could make an impression. The Allied march forward began to slow as the weather turned for the worse. On the 28th of November, General Anderson launched an assault against the town of Jedeida, but the Germans were there in force, armed with giant Tiger tanks. For 2 days, the battle raged as all Allied attempts to capture the town were repulsed, with heavy casualties inflicted. There was worse to come. On the 1st of December, the Axis defenders went over to the offensive, pushing the men of the First Army back to the town of Bebourba. If any Allied commanders had doubted their enemy's willingness to fight for Tunisia, they could now be sure that this was not the case. Thank you. enemy activity was not the only problem for the First Army. The local terrain proved as much of an obstacle as the increasingly visible Axis forces. By the 2nd of December, the main Allied advance had ground to a halt, short of two strategic hills, 40 miles to the west of Tunis. One became known as Longstop, the other was given the name Hill 609. All attempts to capture the hills failed as heavy storms turned the regional landscape into a nightmare environment of wet, clinging mud. Any sort of infantry advance became impossible. The mud could pull the boots off a soldier's feet. Motorized and armored units also suffered in the harsh terrain. For 3 weeks, the First Army were forced to consolidate their positions. All the time, the forces that opposed them were growing. By the end of November, the newly formed 5th Panzer Army had 15,500 men in Tunisia. By the end of December, it could boast 47,000 Germans and 18,000 Italians. Panzer deliveries included a consignment of the impressive Type 6 Tigers. And the new Axis Army was commanded by a respected veteran of the fighting in Russia, General Hans-Jürgen von Arnim. But the Allied commanders were keen to maintain the initiative. On December the 24th, General Anderson ordered a final push towards Tunis. The British 1st Armoured Division were tasked with the assault, with infantry support deployed against the two strategic hills to the north of the front line. In the sodden, muddy conditions, the result was predictable. The British tanks became bogged down, and the infantry found themselves cruelly exposed on the hills. For the men of the Coldstream Guards, Christmas 1942 was a miserable affair as they wrestled with the enemy for possession of Longstop Hill. It was a grim business. Despite some initial hard-won progress, the guardsmen were soon pushed back by withering Axis fire as Eisenhower realized that he would have to wait for an effective assault on the Tunisian capital. On the 24th of December, the American commander made a visit to the front line. Afterwards, he noted his impression of the conditions. The rain fell constantly. I observed an incident which, as much as anything else, convinced me of the hopelessness of an attack. About 30 feet off the road, in a field that appeared to be covered with winter wheat, a motorcycle had become stuck in the mud. Four soldiers were struggling to extricate it, but in spite of their most strenuous efforts, succeeded only in getting themselves mired into the sticky clay. We went back to headquarters, and I directed that the attack be postponed. It was a bitter decision. Eisenhower's disappointment was understandable. By the beginning of the new year, a near-static front line had formed, stretching from the Mediterranean inland to the town of Gafsa. First Army now consisted of the British 5th Corps in the north and the American 2nd Corps in the south. Between them, the new 19th Corps, drawn from the French colonial troops stationed in North Africa. It was a long front for one army to deal with. Some individual battalions had to cover a length of 6 miles. Early January was a time for hard patrol duty. Engagements with the enemy were generally small and localized. Allied ground commanders knew there was still much to learn before victory was achieved. But elsewhere, the Allied High Command were already thinking beyond the Tunisia campaign. On January the 14th, 1943, one of the major Allied war conferences opened in the Moroccan city of Casablanca. There was much for Roosevelt and Churchill to discuss. The progress of the Tunisian fighting was high on the agenda. At Casablanca, the decision was made to form a new Allied 18th Army group under the command of General Sir Harold Alexander. This new command combined the 1st Army in Tunisia with the 8th Army, then advancing through Libya. At the time of the Casablanca conference, Montgomery's men were still in pursuit of Rommel's Panzerarmee Afrika, and it would not be long before both forces reached Tunisia. But it was Rommel's colleague, Hans-Jürgen von Arnim, who made the next move in the Tunisian fighting. The Allied front line included a French position in the mountain range known as the Eastern Dorsalis. The mountain terrain was just one feature of the Tunisian landscape that made for tough fighting conditions in the months ahead. Tight mountain passes, exposed valley plains, and marshy riverbed lands known as wadis all added to the difficulties of effective soldiering. Montgomery's men would find the wadi terrain a particular hindrance during the Tunisian spring. But in early 1943, the Tunisian landscape was not the only problem facing the men of First Army. The French troops of 19th Corps were equipped with weapons that were all but obsolete. Their arsenals were designed for colonial administration, not for engagements with German panzer units. General von Armin was well aware of this. His decision to attack the French sector of the Allied line on January the 18th was well thought, and the French troops soon felt the force of a mechanized monster. At El Alamein, Rommel never received the consignment of 55-ton Tiger tanks that Hitler had promised him. But von Armin did receive a quota of Type 6 panzers. Though not quick enough for divisional use, the Tiger's 88mm gun could make a powerful impact on any battlefield, as the French found out on the 18th of January 1943. By the end of January 1943, the Panzerarmee Afrika of Erwin Rommel had completed its epic retreat from El Alamein in Egypt to the lands of southern Tunisia. It was an amazing achievement in itself, but Rommel also managed to stay several days ahead of his pursuers, the 8th Army of General Montgomery. As soon as Rommel reached Tunisia, it was obvious that he would take advantage of a fortified defensive position in the south of the country. Known as the Marath Line, this was a series of fortifications constructed by the French colonial authorities prior to the war. It was intended to provide security against any Italian invasion launched from Libya. Though its pillboxes, bunkers, and anti-tank defences had fallen into disrepair, the Marath Line could still provide valuable protection for Rommel against the advancing 8th Army of Montgomery. But when the Panzerarmee Afrika arrived at the Marath Line on January the 26th, its commander realized that he still had time to spare before Montgomery arrived. So Rommel decided to leave a mainly Italian force of six divisions to guard the defenses, while he journeyed north with his own armored Afrika Corps. In early February, Rommel considered his next move in discussions with his colleague von Armin. It was well known that the two men were not best of friends. Rommel considered von Armin to be unimaginative. Von Armin thought Rommel to be reckless and impulsive. But the two army commanders were able to put aside their differences as they planned a genuine offensive against the line of the Allied First Army. On February the 14th, 1943, the 10th and 21st German Panzer Divisions launched their attack against positions held by the American 2nd Corps. The mighty Tigers were again deployed as blitzkrieg warfare came to the Tunisian mountains. An initial assault by Stuka dive bombers paved the way for the German army to break through the Faid Pass as the 21st Panzer Division swept through the mountains to the south. It was an occasion when the anti-tank bazooka weapon failed to make a difference to the outcome of battle. In a matter of hours, the American 2nd Corps was in retreat towards the Kasserine Pass, leaving 2,500 men surrounded in the hills. On the evening of the 15th, the town of Sidi Bouzid fell to the panzers after an attempted counterattack by the American 1st Armored Division ended in disaster. On the open plain, the American tanks were picked off with ease, as 2nd Corps Commander Lloyd Fredenhall barked increasingly incoherent orders from his distant headquarters. By the 20th of February, 2nd Corps was formed into a defensive position at the Kasserine Pass, as Rommel's motorized units completed their advance from the southern sector of the front. The Kasserine Pass was strategically vital. If it was captured, the key Allied supply base at Tabesa was also likely to fall, but its defenders could not withstand the German assault on the 20th of February. For the Allies, there was now the real danger of an enemy advance into Algeria, potentially cutting off the First Army from its supply lines. But the Axis forces had to concern themselves with their own extended supply lines, and their commanders argued bitterly about what to do next. Typically, Rommel wanted to be bold, while von Armin argued for consolidation of the territory gained. Valuable time was wasted in indecision. The Allies also began to fight back. At Tala, the British 6th Armoured Division finally halted the German advance. At Tabesa, it was American artillery that played the key role. It was remarkable that the big American guns were even there. In the previous 4 days, the American 9th Division journeyed some 400 miles from their base at Oran to play their part in the fighting, and they arrived just in time. Now Rommel and his colleagues realized that the advance had run out of steam. Having inflicted 3,000 casualties on the American 2nd Corps and taken 4,000 prisoners, the Desert Fox decided to withdraw from the mountains of central Tunisia. He was now ready to turn and face an old rival for the last time on the North African battlefield. The Second World War was a conflict that involved vast numbers of men under arms. By the end of February 1943, the North African theatre alone saw two army groups locked in combat. The Allied 18th Army Group and the Axis Army Group Africa, formed on the 23rd of February, with Field Marshal Rommel in command. But the private, personal element of human rivalry can never be fully removed from warfare. And in North Africa, there was no greater personal contest than that between Erwin Rommel and Bernard Montgomery. Both commanders were charismatic figures and a great inspiration to their men. Rommel especially was almost worshipped by his troops during his great victories of 1941 and 1942. But the two men were different in their approach to warfare. Rommel was bold, always looking to exploit any opportunity for the big breakthrough. His rival Monty was more cautious, as he revealed with his steady pursuit of Rommel through Libya after his victory at El Alamein. But in early February 1943, Montgomery's 8th Army finally arrived in Tunisia, and by the 20th, British troops controlled the town of Medinine to the south of the Marath Line. But further progress would be difficult. 6 Axis divisions were in position at the line, as Rommel swept south with 3 armoured divisions of his own to rejoin battle with his great adversary. Having left an Italian division to hold the American 2nd Corps in the north, the Desert Fox decided that it was time for one of his trademark outflanking manoeuvres. His plan was to bring his panzers to the south of the Marath Line to attack the 8th Army's left flank near Medinine. His intention was to make his move from the slopes of the Matmata Hills, and his chosen date was determined as March the 6th. It was time for the Desert Fox and Monty to test their battle skills once more. Unfortunately for Rommel, Montgomery knew he was coming. Once again, the British code-breaking operation known as Ultra made a vital contribution to the Allied war effort. When Montgomery was made aware of his enemy's intentions, he was able to organize a formidable defensive position all along the line of attack selected by Rommel. Heavily camouflaged anti-tank guns were brought into the line, as Montgomery deployed 2 full-strength divisions, one of them armoured, in the early days of March. All he had to do now was wait. On the morning of March the 6th, Rommel's 3 panzer divisions appeared out of the mist on the slopes of the Matmata foothills. They could not have known they were advancing into a trap. The British gunners waited until the panzers were within a quarter of a mile. Then the assault began. For the first time, the British were able to call on the power of the 17-pound anti-tank gun. Its 76mm shells were able to penetrate armour up to 130mm thick. Not even the mighty Tiger could survive a direct hit from this awesome weapon. Rommel's attack was soon in serious trouble, as panzer wreckage began to clutter the plain. But it wasn't just the big anti-tank guns that made an impression in the Battle of Medellin. The more traditional 6-pound weapon also proved itself. One British gunner succeeded in taking out 8 panzers by himself with his 57mm caliber weapon. It was typical of the day. In a matter of hours, Rommel's proud armoured divisions were in disarray. When the German field marshal eventually ordered a retreat behind the Matmata Hills, he'd lost 52 of his panzers. It was the Desert Fox's last action in Africa. On March the 8th, he flew to see his supreme commander in an attempt to persuade him to withdraw from the theatre altogether. But Hitler refused to listen, and it was his North African commander who was ordered out of the region. Rommel was already ill with jaundice, and he was sent on sick leave, never to return to the battlefield where he made his name. His rival Hans-Jürgen von Armin took over his command and waited for Montgomery's next move. In the weeks that followed the Battle of Medellin, both sides took time to consolidate and regroup. Command of the American Second Corps was removed from the incompetent Lloyd Fredenhaugh and given to George Patton. The new commander moved quickly to restore morale and discipline in the 4 divisions under his command. Patton was also swiftly into action, mounting attacks at the southern end of the Eastern Dorsalis. His intention was to draw Axis resources away from the Marath line. Patton knew this was Bernard Montgomery's next objective. In reality, it was obvious to both sides, but although the 8th Army now held the advantage in men and material, the task of breaking through the Axis defences would not be easy. By March the 20th, the British commander was confident enough to make his move. His plan was for his 30th Corps to attack straight into the enemy line, advancing through the riverbed terrain of the Wadi Zigjau. As a diversionary measure, he also dispatched an infantry division on a huge outflanking manoeuvre through the desert lands around the Matmata Hills. Just as he had done at El Alamein, Montgomery began his assault on the Marath line at night. At 22:30 hours on the 20th of March, a huge artillery barrage hammered the mainly Italian defenders. 30 minutes later, the men of 30th Corps advanced into the Wadi Zigjau with limited armoured support. It soon became clear that the terrain was a formidable handicap. It began to rain heavily on the afternoon of the 22nd of March, and the riverbed ground turned into a sea of mud that proved all but impassable. The Italian defenders, led by General Messe, also put up a vigorous resistance to the 8th Army attack. The British had made virtually no inroads into the Marath line defences, and the afternoon of the 22nd saw a powerful counterattack by the tanks of the 15th Panzer Division. The light British Valentine tanks made an easy target for the panzers, and the men of the 8th Durham Light Infantry soon found themselves in a desperate battle to hold their position. To the northwest, the supporting attack by Freyberg's New Zealanders also struggled to make any impact south of El Hamma. By the early hours of the 23rd of March, it was clear that the 8th Army attack was not proceeding as well as had been hoped. So Montgomery changed his plan. He decided to turn his diversionary attack into the main thrust of the offensive. 10th Corps and the 1st Armoured Division were dispatched into the desert in pursuit of the New Zealanders. Their intention was to join forces and attack the enemy's rear behind the Marath line. This was the so-called left hook, to knock the Axis forces out. But the enemy second-guessed Montgomery's thinking. With only a limited British attack in progress against the line itself, the Italian General Mersey was able to reinforce his rear, setting up a battery of defences against the likely direction of the Allied attack. His firepower included the legendary 88mm German gun, and the 88 proved itself once more when the British armoured units made their move to the south of El Hamma at 1600 hours on March the 26th. Once again, the Italian troops put up a noteworthy defence against the British tanks, but the Axis defenders were not only attacked from the ground. In a devastating raid, a total of 22 squadrons from the British Desert Air Force created mayhem in the German and Italian lines. The aircraft included the Spitfire and the American P-40 fighter bomber, known as the Kitty Hawk in British service. The air assault also featured a British warplane that had proved especially deadly in the fighting at El Alamein. This was the Hurricane 2D anti-tank fighter, armed with two 40mm cannon. Many Allied men referred to the Hurricane as the Tank Buster. Others preferred a nickname that perhaps better described the aircraft's impact on enemy armour. The Hurricane 2D was also known as the Tin Opener. On the 26th of March 1943, the 2D Hurricanes pummeled the Axis defences, and it wasn't long before the 1st British Armoured Division broke through in the direction of the Wadi Akarit. But as the compelling engagement continued, General Mersey succeeded in withdrawing his men some 40 miles to a new defensive position south of the riverbed. The retreat was made in good order, and the new Axis defensive line was well chosen. It was a narrow 8-mile length of front, protected by a number of hills. Montgomery may have won the Battle of the Marath Line, but he would need a new offensive to break through at Wadi Akarit. His Italian rival suspected that Montgomery would attack at night, under the light of the next full moon, on April the 19th. Montgomery decided to surprise him. The British commander was now aware of the pressure of time. At the Casablanca Conference of January 1943, it was decided that final victory in North Africa should be achieved by May the 15th, giving the Allies time to prepare for a summer invasion of Sicily. With this in mind, Montgomery decided to attack the Wadi Akarit on April the 5th, under the light of the new moon. This time, the breakthrough was decisive. An attack by a battalion of Gurkhas led to the capture of the strategically vital hill of Jebel Fatnasser, before a mammoth artillery barrage shattered the Italian positions prior to an Allied infantry advance. But once again, the Italians fought with a tenacity that many of their enemy thought beyond them, as the narrow front line shook with the force of battle. In the Italian rear, the German 15th Panzer Division added their contribution, but by late afternoon on April the 6th, it was clear that the Allied superiority in men and materials was going to win the day. Mersey asked his commander, von Armin, to order a general retreat, and his request was accepted. By the end of April the 6th, the Axis Army Group Africa was heading north towards the vicinity of Tunis itself, as Patton's American 2nd Corps engaged from the rear. The following day, 2nd Corps joined up with the advance units of Montgomery's force. 1st Army was now joined with 8th Army, and the final engagements of the battle for Tunisia were just days away. By the middle of April 1943, Adolf Hitler had all but given up on the fighting in North Africa, but his orders were to defend to the last man, and his theatre commander, Hans-Jürgen von Armin, was willing to fight on till the end. Von Armin did not know of the Allies' desire for victory by May the 15th, but he was determined to delay the triumph of his enemy for as long as he possibly could. By the 22nd of April, von Armin had established a final defensive perimeter around Tunis and Bizerte in the northeast of Tunisia. His successful retreat was assisted by a thick minefield that protected his withdrawal from the close attentions of the enemy. The German commander had little choice but to retreat. On the 20th of April, the Allies launched Operation Flak, a huge air and naval blockade of Tunisian territory. All sea and air transports were destroyed by the Allies. Nothing could get through from Italy to von Armin's trapped men, who were now left with virtually no tanks or fuel to run them. On April the 22nd, 1943, the men of the British First Army's 78th Division set about unfinished business from 4 months before. The previous December, the Allied attack on Longstop Hill to the west of Tunis had ground to a halt in grim winter conditions. In the North African spring, the outcome was different. A heavy intervention from the artillery paved the way for a decisive infantry assault against the hill. At almost the same time, the relocated American 2nd Corps captured Hill 609 with an armoured assault that surprised the Axis defenders. As the Shermans swept over the crest of the hill, the Allied commanders could believe that the path to Tunis and Bizerta was clear, and victory could be achieved before the May the 15th deadline. But the exhausted Panzerarmee Afrika continued to resist. Hitler had ordered that von Armin's men should fight to the end, and in the last week of April, the exhausted force of 175,000 succeeded in holding back the First Army in the west and the Eighth Army in the south. But these two armies comprised some 380,000 men, including some of the most experienced of all desert soldiers. On May the 6th, another massive artillery barrage preceded a British assault against the centre of the line at the Megerda Gap. By the end of the day, they had overcome what was left of Axis resistance. The end was now in sight. The following day, the advance guard of the British 7th Armoured Division swept into Tunis, to the delight of the city's inhabitants. At virtually the same moment, Omar Bradley's Americans arrived in the port of Bizerta to the north. In both locations, the Allies found virtually no resistance. The remaining Axis forces had fled to the Cape Bon Peninsula to the east, where von Armin intended to make his last stand. There was little else he could do. The Allied blockade meant that escape was all but impossible, and von Armin's code of honour compelled him to fight on to the last bullet. German and Italian armoured divisions waited until they had exhausted all fuel and ammunition before surrendering to the Allies. Only then, on May the 12th, 1943, did the fighting come to an end. Tunisia was in Allied hands. And so were the remains of the Army Group Afrika. Hans-Jürgen von Armin was the most senior prisoner taken out of a total which the Allies claimed was some 250,000. The precise number may never be known. What is certain is that only 638 men defied the Allied blockade and reached safety in Italy. On May the 13th, General Alexander was able to inform Churchill that final victory had been achieved, and it had been secured within the designated timescale. Alexander's communication to his Prime Minister was a triumph of factual simplicity. "Sir, it is my duty to report that the Tunisian campaign is over. All enemy resistance has ceased. We are the masters of the North African shores." For the Allies, the Tunisian campaign had been an overwhelming success. Americans and British proved they could fight in the same army. The quality and quantity of Allied weapons had also proved significant, and the individual Allied soldier had acquitted himself well in fighting conditions that were often harsh. Their enemy also fought well, with the Italians revealing a newfound stomach for the fight in North Africa. In the end, the undoubted bravery of the Axis troops was not enough to prevail against a numerically superior opponent. Victory in Tunisia meant that Churchill and the Allied leadership could enjoy a moment of cheer. The way was now clear for the Allies to take the war into the enemy's homeland, Sicily, and then Italy itself would be the next objectives as World War II came to an end in Africa and headed north into Europe.